Welcome to the FaceTime with God podcast. I'm your host, Kay Farrar, and yes, you have tuned in to the right place because we're bringing Christ to the culture and the culture to Christ. Because the gospel's not for old times, it's for all times. So we've got relevant topics, real people, and we're starting right now. So counseling and just your recent life. All right. So you brought us up to speed, and really today kind of we're just doing a little, you know, deep dive.
Yeah.
Who Teresh is, you know, an overcomer, a power packer, you know, an entrepreneur, all these good things, a wife, a believer. A listener to the voice of God. So all of these things, but what else about you? And I know you were sharing, you know, health challenge that popped up.
So. So about 4 years. So I told you my mom passed away 4 years ago. Yeah, she passed away in 2020, 4 years ago, 3.5 years ago. We were out at a picnic. And with our church, I had outreach outside, and my father-in-law now, so same pastor, Pastor Wilson, had come up to me. I had been dealing with what I thought was sinus issues for probably like 3 months, something like that. But it was the summer. I'm thinking, you know, allergies and stuff like this. So he comes up to me. He was like, you should go to the hospital. You know, it wasn't nothing deep. He wasn't like the voice of God has told me. He was just like, you should go and get checked out. So this is, I have to make the connection. A part of God's healing for me has come through my relationship with father figures. So if I take somebody in as a father figure, I listen to what they tell me. But I also, if I don't agree with them, I can, you know, we have open conversation, you know? And so he told me that. And I guess because he probably didn't think I was going to do it, you know, because I'm busy all the time. But I did it that night. Haven, thank God he wasn't working. And I was, which was crazy because he usually works the night shift. At that time, he was working night shift. And so I was like, oh, he don't got to go to work. I'm going to go ahead and go. Went to the hospital. And they told me it was on COVID. So you get your test and then you go back outside. I mean, they check you in and you go back outside and wait in the car. When by the time I had come back in, they were like, we need to do a chest x-ray. And I'm like, okay. You know, I thought it was this, I don't know what it was for, right? Just because of the times that we were in. COVID. The doctor comes in, like, oh, you can go wait in the room. Doctor comes in and she's like, you know, I don't know how to tell you this. I'm thinking to myself, just give me some Benadryl, something. It ain't that deep, you know? And she's like, you're dying. So my immediate response was, oh, I'm sorry. You came in the wrong room. My name is Teresh Wilson.
You probably said it really. Teresh?
Yes.
You probably spelled it.
Literally. So she's like, looking at me like, what is wrong with this lady? I'm sitting crisscross applesauce up on the exam table, just, you know, waiting for them to come in. And she's like, ma'am, I'll be right back. So she goes, gets my x-ray, comes back in. And she came back in, and like this time, so she's putting the x-ray up. So I see the x-ray, and there's this like this big white thing on the x-ray. So I'm like, what is that? So I'm trying to let her do her process. But I'm like, what is that? Why is she bringing, she need to know she's bringing other people's stuff in here. It's not, this ain't me, you know? So she I'm like, what is that on the board? So she turns around, her eyes are like glossy, like she's tearing up. And she's like, ma'am, that's what I'm trying to tell you.
Wow.
And I was like,
and you know, they see this stuff all the time.
Literally.
I have that kind of reaction.
Literally. So I'm like, but in my brain, it wasn't clicking. I was still like, oh, she's thinking that, oh, I'm not sick though. And I don't know why she's not understanding this. So she was like, that's what I'm trying to tell you. She was like, this is your heart. Now that caught my attention.
Because you could see the x-ray.
Because I could see the x-ray. And I'm like, that's my heart, you know? She's like, yes. I was like, how big is my heart supposed to be? because I'm a therapist. I'm not science. I don't do math. Mm-hmm. I don't do any of that. Mm-hmm. And so I was skipping class doing all of that stuff, to be honest. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, she was like, your heart should be this size, but once it expands, swells, it calcifies at the same time. So it can never go back down. Mm-hmm. And what I'm telling you is, with your heart this enlarged, your heart could burst. You can have a stroke. Mm. You can have a heart attack. Mm. She was like, there's like 5 different things that can happen that are all life threatening, equaling death. And we just don't know when it's going to happen. So I was like, what? So she's like, who can you call? Well, can you get your whoever brought you here? I'm like, I drove. She was like,
What was going on in your life during that time? I mean, is there anything diet-wise or in your environment where you're around, like they were building something and some chemicals were coming out? I mean, is there anything that would indicate
no
where in the world this came from?
Like, no. So the only thing that eventually I met my nephrologist. Mm-hmm. He asked about the COVID vaccinations, because I did get vaccinated. Huh. He said, but he was actually, I'm telling, this is, man, when I tell you, God just loves me. I know that.
Yes.
So the nephrologist that I got, he was one of few that were called into a government study to study the effects of the COVID vaccinations, all of them, on the kidneys. Mm. He was the nephrologist that God gave me in the emergency room the next morning at St. Mary's. So he didn't tell me that initially. He just was like walking me through it. And then when my numbers, so my blood pressure, they treated my blood pressure. That was through the roof. They treated everything. He tested me for everything under the sun, everything. And so then he told me, This is also a part of a study that I'm a part of. He said, if this is actually a result of the COVID vaccinations, it's a very small percentage that we've seen anything even close to anything like this. We've never seen this. Uh-huh. But if there has been any change to your kidneys, it will resolve itself within 6 months. Okay. He was like, we'll start to see a decline. So we're going to start you on dialysis. Mm-hmm. So I've been waiting for 3.5 years now. Mm-hmm. So there's never been any decline.
Okay. I got you. And just a quick pause, because you shared about the heart being enlarged.
Mm-hmm.
And then you shared about your blood pressure. And you kind of went over to the kidney part.
Mm-hmm.
But during that, just for everybody to catch up.
Oh, absolutely. Yes. Process, thank you.
So in the different tests that they ran,
right,
because apparently, basically, your system was kind of going haywire.
So let me tell you about my heart. So I was freaking out because I see my heart.
Mm-hmm.
I went to St. Mary's. The next morning, I had the same nursing staff overnight, but all these different specialists were coming in my room all night. So nobody was talking to me. So the next morning, my nurse was still in there and she's checking on me and all of this. And I was like, how is my heart? Because one thing about being during COVID time, I don't know if y'all remember this or not, nobody could come in the hospital with you.
Right.
They did eventually let my husband come in an emergency room with me once I got assigned to a room.
Mm-hmm.
But
this was 2021?
This is 2021.
Okay, yeah.
So I'm just sitting in there by myself until he comes in there. And so nobody's really telling me anything, but the nursing staff, you know, they got to know me or whatever, just sitting in there. So the next morning, I'm like, what is going on with my heart? And they were like, what do you mean? And I said, my heart, because hear in my ears are, my heart is about to explode. I have 2 children. Like, I can't die right now, you know?
Mm-hmm. And based on what the first lady or whatever initially you were told.
Not even told, what I saw.
Okay.
I saw the x-ray.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And so she was like, hold on. She ran out. She was like, she came back in a few minutes and she was like, I just wanted to check your charts. She said, I don't know what happened, but your heart is normal. Mm. I said, what? She was like, there is nothing wrong with your heart. She was like, it's not enlarged. There's no complications. Your heart is the least of our worries.
Mm.
I was like, what you mean? I said, how did it go back down? She was like, I don't even know what you mean. How did it go back down?
Mm-mm.
It wasn't even enlarged.
Mm-mm-mm-mm.
I was like, that's what I'm saying. God, you be doing, I be having to go through some stuff. But I know you love me, for real.
Wow.
Yeah. So, because that would have been the only thing that could not have ever been treated. Kidneys, gotcha. You can do dialysis. You can get a new kidney. I would have had to get a new heart immediately because that heart was almost gone. Mm. Never had any other complications or anything. Yeah. So
that is a miracle and a blessing.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. So as a result of all of that, you kidneys. You did need to be treated. And so.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So I'm on dialysis. I did in-center for a month. That was the process. It was very hard. Pray for those people that are in center on dialysis. It's very, very hard.
Because you're in there, in the room 24/7?
No, you're in the room. You go to the room every other, like, maybe every 2 days.
Okay.
But by the time you go back, so if you're not urinating, you have no other way of expelling toxins from your body.
Okay.
So thankfully, that was never my issue. I never had no signs or anything like that. Still, everything is good. But most people do not urinate anymore. So the toxins are just building up over 2 or 3 days. Right. And then so you go in there, you're hooked to a machine. I had a port right here. I have a scar right here. You're hooked to a machine. Your blood is taken out. Your blood is cleaned in a machine. And then your blood is put back into you. But the thing is, they can only heat your blood back up to a certain temperature. And the warmest they can get it, it literally feels like ice in your veins.
Wow.
So not only are you tired because you the just got all this drain, right? But you're now, you're freezing.
Wow.
On another level of cold. Wow. And it's like, it's like somebody putting nitrogen or something in your, like that thing to make you cold, right?
Wrap y'all all up. Listen. It's not physical. It's not like an external.
Everybody
force.
In there. It was the middle of the summer. My husband, my kids would come pick me up. I would have on a Scully. I would have on, I had my sweatshirt on, pulled tight. I would have on layers of shirts and put a coat on top of it. And when I'm in there, I still have a blanket over me. And you still sitting there shaking because it's like your bones are iced.
Yeah.
And it's miserable. But then I got the opportunity by the grace of God to be able to do my dialysis at home. So I still can live my life. I'm with my kids. I work, and I do it overnight. And one thing I was telling you, it actually kind of taught me, highlighted the ways that I wasn't caring for myself. Like before I started dialysis at home, I can't tell you the last time I got an 8-hour night sleep. Like, what you mean? I don't even, And I used to always say, oh, because I had kids. I don't sleep like that because I had kids. But it was like, no, you really have to take care of yourself so you can take care of other people.
And what was your life like before then, though? I mean, you said...
Before dialysis?
You said you never didn't get an 8-hour sleep.
Oh, yeah, no.
So what else not good care? I mean, what...
So I'm a therapist. My whole time... all my career is about caring for others. Being a mom is about caring for my children. Being a wife, thankfully I got a good husband, so I don't feel the burden of like, oh, I only have to care for him. Like, it was really fair. It's even, right? But, I still love him. So, I do want to try to take care of him. But everything in my life was about giving, right? So... even if I was up late, it wasn't because I was doing something to give it to myself. It was because I was probably up thinking about something else I had to do for somebody else. I maybe slept 6 hours a night,
As a counselor, and you were a counselor all during this time. Do you think you were taking the burdens of, the people you were counseling?
Yeah.
Just internally, or were you like doing like, they need a job. Let me go see if I can find. Were you just carrying a lot of the work with you 24/7? What did all of that look like?
So what you just said.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. The one thing that I did stop doing was counseling children, per se, because I had children. And because I am that person. Like, if you have a need, I'm like, oh, okay. So that's what we're dealing with. And I do mean we. I'm like, how are we going to fix this?
Yeah.
I got 6 jobs for you. It's just like,
yeah,
that's just naturally who I am. Like, I couldn't turn it off. Mm-hmm. That's not bad. It's just I didn't have anything on the other side to balance it out for myself.
Yeah.
You know, that's one reason why I feel like my husband, he's still my best friend, mm-hmm. you know, because when he see me doing too much, mm-hmm. he'll be like, you know, you need to pull back. Mm-hmm. And normally, you know, we used to fight about that because I'm like, what you mean? But they need, you know, he's like,
yeah.
what is wrong with you?
Yeah.
You know, but, you know, I learned, you know, he really, I know the Bible says, like, you know, the wife is the man's helpmate, but, like, he is my friend. Yeah. He is my friend, yeah. you know, so he really so be awesome. Taking care of me. Yeah.
So what is the day in the life?
Today,
sundown, how does it go down?
So today, I would say, I get up, I'm usually still connected to my dialysis. Mm-hmm. So I'll get up, generally he'll get up, our youngest daughter goes to school first. He'll get her up and get her dressed. I try to at least be up and you know, so I can talk and say my byes to mm-hmm. them or whatever. He'll take them to school and I'll take my son to school. He's older. He goes high school. It's a little later.
Mm-hmm.
And so do that from, I don't know, maybe like, so about a few weeks ago, the beginning of April, I just went out on my job for a short-term disability. Mm-hmm. So before that, I would just go immediately, take my son to school, go immediately upstairs and just work from home, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. do that. Now it's kind of flexible because I might have doctor's appointments and all of these things to go through. Cause being on a transplant wait list, it's a waiting game,
okay.
but you have a lot of appointments cause yeah. you have to make sure that everything, yeah. you know, and thank God. Never had any issues. Everything, my numbers, everything looked great.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just waiting, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So I do that. Our kids get out of school. My daughter's in after school. So about 4 o'clock, I turn back on my mom hat
mm-hmm.
and our kids do sports.
Mm-hmm.
So I love being a part of all of that
mm-hmm.
with them.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be honest with you, a moment of transparency for real. Not that I've been shy
mm-hmm.
this whole time,
mm-hmm.
but even yesterday we had a conversation, me and my husband
mm-hmm.
had a conversation because I realized some things like you could just take for granted. I have to force myself to talk and be, I can talk fine, but
mm-hmm.
When I'm feeling scared or
mm-hmm.
vulnerable about a situation,
mm-hmm.
Even though I don't trust anybody more in this life than my husband,
mm-hmm.
nobody,
mm-hmm.
you know, I know, like even on our worst days, he used to say this thing, how he knew that I was going to be his wife,
wow.
that even at my maddest, if he put his heart in my hand,
mm-hmm.
he knew I wouldn't crush it. And I'll be like, how you know that?
So awesome.
Cause I might do it, you know, but now I feel like that with him.
Mm-hmm.
Like even on my worst
wow.
day, like
mm-hmm.
we could just have a terrible argument. Like, but I still be like, can you give me a cup of water? And he might be mad.
Mm-hmm.
He might be like, I'm going to make you wait 5 minutes. Yeah.
I ain't going to feel it all the way to the top.
Yeah. But he's going to get, because he's my friend.
Yeah.
You know?
That is so awesome.
And it's like so I had to tell him, you know, sometimes I push myself a little too hard though for my kids because, you know, he asked a question like, you know, do you feel like you're doing this because you have a fear that you won't be here with them?
Mm-hmm.
And, I can't say I've never had that fear.
Mm-hmm.
I have had that fear, but like I said, I know God loved me. And I don't say that in a conceited way. It's just, man, when you grow up being beat for no reason
mm-hmm.
and just treated terrible
mm-hmm.
for no reason, like you just automatically assume that nobody really cares about you like that.
Mm-hmm.
So when God repeatedly shows you, like, not only am I going to take care of you, but I see you.
Yes.
And, like, this orchestrates your life in a way
yeah.
that, like, there's no other way that I can even convince myself that you don't care about me, God. Like, I know you love me. So I don't have that fear that I won't be here with my kids. What bothers me more is that in order to get to the other side of this thing,
mm-hmm.
Once... you know, I get my kidney transplant. is that I'm going to miss a part of their life. I won't be able to be the mom that I want to be. And I had a great mom, a great mother. I mean, awesome. Would never have traded her for anything in this world. And I want my kids to know that, you know, if nobody else is in the stands cheering for you, mm-hmm. I'm going to be there. Yeah. Daddy going to be there. Daddy going to be cool and calm and collected because that's who he is. But mommy going to be the fool. Yeah, I'm going to be the, yeah, I'm going to make the noise. And so, and knowing that I won't, I might have to miss some time because after I get my transplant.
It's the process.
Yeah, it's the process. Yeah. And I'm like, I don't look forward to that day. Mm-hmm. And so I push myself, but I retire probably about 10 or 11 o'clock at night. Mm-hmm. My time has gotten a little bit more lax now that I'm not working full time. But, you know, when the sun go down, I try to be like, all right, I need to get ready to get on my machine so I can start up tomorrow and yeah. I'll be ready to go. Uh-huh. And so
you get on that. Is there a certain time every night or is it just around 10?
I try to get on by 10 because it's an 8-hour process.
Gotcha.
So I even look at that. Like, that's a part of God's grace for me, because it forces me to lay down or be still enough. I can walk around my room. Mm-hmm. I can be in a confined space, but I gotta chill.
Yeah.
You know, I gotta just let whatever is happening downstairs or in my kids' room.
Yeah.
It gotta happen.
Okay, mommy on her machine.
Yeah. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, but it forces me to be like, let him do what he gonna do.
Yeah.
You know, let my kids be the kids that we're raising them to be.
Yeah.
You know, and just trust God. Mm-hmm. You know, and just think about your day. Sit down. What show you wanna watch? Mm-hmm. Cause you only got like 5 minutes. Cause you know you about to go to sleep. Now my body has totally adjusted to that.
Yeah.
Cause it's like as soon as I plug up, I'll be like, come on, baby, we gonna watch this show, and he'll be like, Cause he know in 5 minutes I'm gonna be like, okay. Once I roll over.
Wow.
See you in the morning.
Wow. And how old are your kids?
15 and 7. 15
okay.
and 7. Yeah.
That's right. 15
yep.
and 7.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
7. Yeah. Double.
Man.
Twice.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right. So I want to give you this. This is a gold key.
Okay.
And imagine that is the key to your next. What does that look like for you? And it can be any, could be as far down the road, or, I mean, what do you see? What do you see in your future?
I'm gonna be honest, it's selfish though. Well, it's not selfish, but people might feel like it's selfish. But, you know, me and my husband, we do a lot I know I said I love hard. He loves hard too. It mm-hmm. just look a little different because he calm and cool and collected, yeah. you okay. know? What I would want my next to be while we push ourselves also for our kids, but I want to be able to randomly take a trip, go to other lands, mm-hmm. not just states. Like, mm-hmm. I want to explore the world, mm-hmm. and it just be me and my best friend, mm-hmm. not our children, mm-hmm. you know, they'll be good.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to go out and experience life in a way that we haven't had the opportunities to just yet mm-hmm. to do that, you know, because we got responsibilities,
mm-hmm.
you know, but I look forward to that and I will have no regrets. We already told our children, you're not going. And even when they were like, well, you're not.
So
no.
I just think that's so awesome, too. So because I've asked a similar question to a lot of people. And I don't think, and I'm, as you know, I'm just kind of thinking back, I don't recall anybody, one, answering with something that concrete.
Yeah, we
talked
about this.
And two, to where they've already discussed it.
Oh, yeah.
Like, you got plans.
We got plans. Listen,
you know what I mean?
They're on a time clock.
And I was I'm trying to remember. I meditate and think over a lot of things. I don't even know if maybe I didn't share this with anyone, but to me, that's the difference between a dream,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
And a fantasy.
Right. Right.
Like, it hadn't materialized yet, but right. guess what? We already,
we're gone.
And we made a decision. Literally. And we got some plans and
right.
works
right.
towards it. And I think that is so awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing that I think is so awesome about it is that you've got, you know, you got some things that you believe for. You just told us, and we're going to be praying for that.
Mm-hmm.
You just told us that you're, you know, on a transplant list.
Mm-hmm.
But what blesses me about what you just said, whew, I got to hold myself here.
Mm-hmm.
What blesses me about what you just said, I don't even know if you realize that.
Mm-hmm.
You beyond a transplant at that point.
Yeah.
Right? Because mm-hmm. we ain't taking a machine.
Right.
On this trip.
Oh, no. Mm-mm.
So we're already making plans.
Oh, yeah.
For being past this.
Yes.
What a lot of people would say is the biggest, I mean, it's an obstacle.
It is.
But what are obstacles? Something to overcome.
Something to overcome. Period. Literally.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I tell one story I have told before, you know, back in the day, you know, your girl ran track. Yeah. Like, right. I got a few battles. I did. But I was just eager. So mm-hmm. I was telling the guy that's a coach, you know, we won my middle school. We won the district, right?
Oh, okay.
And I helped do that.
Mm-hmm.
But the way I helped do it was like, they'd be like, I'm all up. At that time, I probably was all of 90 pounds, right? Mm-hmm. 5'3".
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you want a high jump? I'm like, okay. What? A lot of teams didn't have girl high jumpers. So I guess I got those points. And you want a shot put? All in 90 pounds. Okay. But they ain't had no other girl. You know, one girl. Okay, so that's the first place medal. But then, so I got points then. And so the coaches were just very strategic.
Yeah.
But in high school, so I'm still eager and I still love to go to track practice, show up, you know, every day do what they tell me. You want to run hurdles? Sure.
Uh-huh.
You know.
Yeah.
But they trained us. So this is really the moral of this story about obstacles, mm-hmm. right? As a hurdler, if you take a sprinter that has not trained to jump hurdles,
mm-hmm.
and you know, they just sprint every day. That's what their practice is about, sprinting. And then you take these wooden objects, you know, and put them in front of them and say, all right, come on, let's go. Everybody, no, full speed. Come on, let's go.
Right.
Just jump over them. They, it would look so ugly.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
They would hit them, fall down. They would hurt themselves.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It would not be pretty.
Yeah.
But take me. I'm a hurdler. Every day in practice, you count your step. Boom, boom, boom. Pop. Boom, boom, boom. Pop. You know, whether it's 3 steps, 4 steps, that's what you do. You train to run full speed. And jump over what? The obstacle.
Yeah.
So that's why I say an obstacle is nothing but something to overcome. And right. for believers, I'm talking about the track example, but for believers, that's who we are.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we used it, prior church, we used the home of the overcomer.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what we are.
Mm-hmm.
So if it's an obstacle, we didn't say we know how. We didn't say we understand why we got the obstacle.
Right.
We didn't say any of that. All we know, we trust God.
That's right.
That we're going to overcome it.
Right.
One of two things.
Right.
Either we're going to go over it.
Right.
He going to move it out the way.
Right.
Whatever the case may be, but that is who we are.
Right.
In him, we overcome it. And I just love the fact that when I asked you about the key to your next, you had already, seriously,
in your spirit,
transplant?
Yeah.
We passed chat. We planning on the trip.
Literally.
We already planned. We already talked. Mm-hmm. Sound like to me. Did you say you already told the kids they not gonna go?
Yeah, we told them.
I love that.
Mm-hmm.
I love that, Jeresh. Mm-hmm. And I'm gonna give you the final word. I mm-hmm. think we might be at a good place. Jeresh will be in 2 parts.
Okay.
But I want to give you, and I'll take that, or you can mm-hmm. hold on to it, whatever you want, because I need to plan a little trip.
Down. Yeah.
You know, but I want to give you the final word, mm-hmm. and just whatever you want to say, however you want to close out.
So I'll say this. When I was in college and I started my relationship with the Lord, one thing that my father-in-law now told me was that before you get ready to jump in and start doing things, first learn to fall in love with God, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, angry because I'm like, what does that even mean? How can I fall in love with God? I don't even see him. And but I learned to fall in love with him through his word. And for years, my favorite verse was Jeremiah 29:11. And I used to wear that thing like a badge. Like, Jeremiah, I know the plans I have, God has for me, all this stuff. But then probably about 10 years ago, God was like, why don't you go read some stuff before that, before Jeremiah 29. And I was like, you have got to be kidding me. This was my favorite verse this whole time, but I didn't know what the people, for those that don't know, the people that God was giving that message to through Jeremiah, God was basically like, this is going to be a situation and it's going to be messed up for a while. And I'm not taking you out of it. I'm going to sustain you through it. You're going to, look, plant gardens, build houses. I'm like, God, why are you telling me? Because you're going to be there. You got to eat. You got to stay warm. You got to stay safe from the elements. Marry, have children, and marry your child. I'm like, what? How long? And then he said, but then I will come and I will deliver you. And that's my life. So no matter what I go through, that's why I can say I know God loves me. Because it's just that same scenario where God is like, oh no, you thought I don't see what's going on with you. I see you. I've seen you this whole time. And it's a part of the process that I have for you. Because when I do come, I'm showing up like myself, like God. And I'm going to do only what I can do. And that's my life. That's what God does. So that's why I just say, okay, Lord.
Amen. Well, this is the life and times of an overcomer. Teresa Wilson. And you have just shared some of that insight. Thank you for being so open. This has been awesome. And I can't wait to be a part of at least I'll wave at you guys.
Yeah.
When you're ready to take that trip.
Yeah.
I'll be celebrating you between now and then.
Yes.
So thank you. Love you so much.
I love you too.
Just your heart, your spirit, everything, your power.
Yeah, thank you.
You're an awesome woman of God.
Thank you.
So thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
Cool. Thank you.
Okay.
Oh, man. Oh, my gosh. Oh, Lord.
Colossians 3:23 and 24. And whatever you do, do it with all your heart as unto the Lord and not unto men, knowing that it's of the Lord that you shall receive the reward of the inheritance, because you serve the Lord Christ.